On today's show,
we debate which MVP favorite is under the most playoff pressure, the Beard or the Brody.
What about Warriors, Steph or KD? How about the leaders of the two seeds, IT or the Claw?
And top 10. We're gonna count down the best plays from the past 7 days.
It's Friday, April 7th. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters, presented by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey. Whether you're joining us live on NBA TV right now, a little bit later on YouTube, doesn't matter. We're happy to have you. I'm Jay Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
This might be controversial, but I believe all cake is good with coffee, so why don't we call them all coffee cakes?
Controversial. two is right. The international man of mystery taking it to the max. Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lenny.
Lee, and last, certainly not least. Over there, it's the big man in the middle. It's Trey Kirby.
Hey,
yo! TK, what do you got?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag TheStarters. And guys, in a world full of bobbleheads, any unusual arena giveaway sticks out. And they got a pretty sweet one in Memphis this weekend. On Sunday, the first 4,000 fans to show up to the game against the Pistons will get a Tony Allen pepper grinder, because he's the grind father and they play in the grind house. It's a simple but brilliant idea. And it brings us to today's question. What other kitchen gadgets could be NBA giveaways? For instance, the Spurs could give away Kawhi Leonard cling wrap because he always sticks to his defender, or the Warriors could give away a Klay Thompson creme brulee torch because he heats up fast. And what kitchen would be complete without a Jose Calderon ham slicer? Slices your Iberico ham so thin. But we want to hear from you, so let us know on Twitter. What other kitchen gadgets could be NBA giveaways? Send us your best tweets to hashtag TheStarters. We'll hear from you later. And if you have opinions on coffee cake, we'll hear those too.
I thought the Klay Thompson would be a toaster for sure.
Oh, good point.
He's been on fire since the toaster.
Also, why were you laughing about Jose Calderon's hams?
I just think they're, I'd love to try them.
Yeah, okay, good.
He's very proud of his hams.
All right, we got a fun show here on a Friday night for you. Tass is going to award the dishonor for worst of the week. And we got the top 10 plays from the past 7 days. But we start with a special edition of What You Got. It's the playoff pressure edition. Trey's going to present us with a couple players, and we're going to debate which guy's facing the most postseason pressure. The catch, of course, is there's only one right answer, and it's whatever TK says it is. All right, Trey.
First one, in a delicious twist of fate, this season's top two MVP candidates, James Harden and Russell Westbrook, will most likely be meeting in the first round of the playoffs. Their first playoffs, mind you, where both guys are the only superstar on their teams. A lot of pressure in that cooker, but who's under more pressure, Harden or Westbrook? What you got?
This is delicious that they're likely to meet in the first round, but I think there's more pressure on James Harden. This is Westbrook's first year as the clear number one guy, but this is really Harden's fifth year. You know, Dwight Howard was definitely the number two there, and in those four previous years, three of the four times, he's out in the first round.
Yeah, and struggled.
Yeah.
With his shot, at least.
He just wasn't himself. And, you know, as the top seed, it's inherently more pressure on him. So I got to go Harden.
Yeah, I agree too, because Westbrook's season, I think, is going to be considered a success no matter what happens from here, because he's shown that he can lead a team without Kevin Durant. He's likely to average a triple-double. He may be the MVP, but I don't think anyone can really look at the Thunder and say they're going to go. They're a chance to get to the finals right now. The Rockets, we know, have matched up okay at times against the Warriors. If they get that far, they could be a chance. I just don't think that we can say the same thing about the Thunder. So I think it's on James Harden.
It is a shame, though, in a way, that one of them wouldn't be announced MVP either before the series would start or during the series, because that would maybe then sort of focus some of this so-called pressure. Mm-hmm. But we're not going to find out, of course, till later in June when we have the NBA awards show. So, you know, take that into consideration. If Westbrook was named the MVP maybe during the series, then maybe he gets a little more. But I agree with you guys. Harden's going to have home court advantage. He has struggled at times in the playoffs, as you said, shooting 40% in the first 2 years, 41% last year. He had the conference finals run, which was great, but I think it's Harden too.
You know what? I've changed my mind.
Why?
Because Russell Westbrook is the Oklahoma City Thunder, and when he goes to the bench, they're so bad. So he may feel pressure just to shoot more and to score more, and he shoots more than James Harden as well, you know, five more times a game. So he just might feel like in-game pressure. Sitting here right now, it's on Harden. But in-game pressure, Westbrook might feel the need to get back on that floor right away, play 46 minutes a game at times. Because when he goes to the bench, again, Samaje Christian hasn't really been doing it as the backup point guard. so much goes through Russ. And listen.
Yeah, but he's not expected, really.
No,
he's not
gonna I totally agree. I just want to give an alternate angle here. You know, let's flip the script.
You want to see the David Robinson and Akeem Olajuwon
situation.
That's
exactly right. Yeah. I mean, I'm excited about the NBA award show, but I don't like that it takes away those type of storylines where, David Robinson was handed the MVP and he was going up against Akeem Olajuwon, who thought maybe he should add it. And then the Dream went and killed him in that series. I mean, we're going to miss out on that in theory, but...
And I think this season is going to be a bit of a learning process for Russell Westbrook as the number one option, because I think after the season's all done, he goes into next year, I think he's going to look back and say, maybe I should have got those guys involved just a little more. Not to bring it back to the whole, hey, shoot less, but the fact that his team is so bad without him, it's not just he just doesn't have the supporting cast. I think he could help make those guys a little better if his usage percentage was just a touch lower.
All right, Trey, what's the answer to this one? Who is going to be facing more postseason pressure?
For me, it's James Harden. You guys nailed it. They're going to be favored. He's had some struggles in the past. They're going to be expected to win. That's a lot of pressure. But moving on, like David Bowie and Freddie Mercury, Steph Curry and Kevin Durant are two superstars on the same team that are under pressure. One's a two-time MVP who hasn't had a classic finals yet. The other famously left his very good team for a chance at the ring. Who's under more pressure? Curry or Durant? What you got?
Kevin Durant. Easily. He would be under way more pressure than Steph Curry because he hasn't won a ring. That comes into play here when you're talking about superstars. You got the rings, theory, or throw that out there that everyone does. He's been away when his team's been rolling. So if he came back and for whatever reason sort of screwed up their flow, he would get the blame for that again, whether it would be right or wrong. And he did the Voltron move to where he left his team and teamed up with the power team, super team, in the 73-win Warriors. The pressure's on KD. I don't even see really what pressure would be on Curry.
It's Steph Curry's team still. If they have three of the most incredible regular seasons in history and only have one championship to show for it, that will be considered a disappointment.
That's one more than KD would
but
have
that's
in
still, it's
his
still,
four or five,
it's still
six
Steph
awesome
Curry's
years.
Team. When you think about the Warriors, you think, this is Steph Curry, the two-time MVP. He's having another fantastic season now, even though it's not looking as good as it was last season. He has to now go on and redeem himself from last season. Remember, even in the two final series, when they won the championship and then lost last year, Steph Curry hasn't had a great final series. He needs to go out there and have a Steph Curry-type series where he takes over, shoots incredibly well from the floor, has some of those Steph Curry moments where you see him score 12, 15 points in a minute
or two. So you're saying because Iguodala won finals MVP the year they won it, and then, obviously giving up the 3-1 lead last year. And
he had
a pretty good reason why he struggled.
Yeah, I know he did. I know he was injured, but he has to go out there. And like I say, he has to cash in on this incredible little run that they've had over these last 3 years. They're probably going to win 67 games again. That's incredible to win that as your benchmark for three seasons.
All right, well, we disagree. Where do you fall on this one?
Well, sitting in between you guys, I think I take a little from you. I think the pressure for Steph Curry will be upon himself to be as good as he was in 2014, as he was a couple years ago when Iggy won it. That's the pressure on him. I think the pressure for KD will come externally from the internet. 3-1! You left. I mean, that's where it's going to come from, I think. But Steph has said something that just woke me up the last few weeks. He basically said, I am the spark that makes this team go. Mm-hmm. And I think he is going to bring that to each and every playoff game. Last year, it just obviously it alerted him. And his offseason made him think every single night, I got to wake up every day and as he says for playoff games, lock in. I think he is going to be ready to just be that spark. Not necessarily score 28 points, but just get the guys going every night. So it's different kinds of pressure, but I think it's equal.
Trey, you have the final say. Who's under real more pressure?
I think it's Durant, too. The whole point of leaving the Thunder was to win a title. That's a lot of pressure.
Yes.
Moving on, both Isaiah Thomas and Kawhi Leonard are going to make MVP ballots this season, and they're both two seeds in their respective conferences. So they're under pressure, too. IT to get his first playoff series win. Kawhi to somehow knock off the Warriors. But which one's under more pressure? Thomas or Leonard? What you got?
Isaiah Thomas. Because the Celtics have had a great season. They're going to finish second in the Eastern Conference, most likely. But so far, this team hasn't won a playoff series. They won a couple of games, but now it's incumbent on them to go out and show we actually can challenge the Cavs in the Eastern Conference. Danny Ainge stood pat at the trade deadline. He felt that those guys that he had could really make a push. But without Isaiah Thomas on the floor, the Celtics struggle. We saw them get exposed, actually, the other night at home against the Cleveland Cavaliers. If Isaiah is... If he's not delivering, then the Celtics don't have a lot of support for him. And in the playoffs, you can really lock in on a guy as well. And I expect teams, whoever faces Celtics, will probably double him, put a lot of pressure, make the other guys around him beat them. And I think that's where Isaiah has to deliver 30, 35 points a night if they're going to have a chance to win.
I know Isaiah Thomas does so much for that team, and they sometimes watch him in fourth quarters mm-hmm. and just say, all right, Isaiah, go do your thing. So I think, you know, in game, there is a ton of pressure on Isaiah Thomas. But as far as being a superstar, I think there's more pressure on Kawhi Leonard because he hasn't really achieved that level quite yet. In 2014, he was named the finals MVP, sure, but that was in a very, very different role. Then last year, you know, 22 points a game in the playoffs, but he didn't really show up in the losses to the OKC Thunder. And he just hasn't taken that next step. You know, we're talking about him as an MVP candidate.
Yeah.
Is he a superstar? Is he a guy who can lead a team? Because this team can't rely on Tony Parker anymore. It can't rely on Tim Duncan anymore. So can Kawhi Leonard be the guy who is a superstar? So he's had playoff success in the past, but can he be the guy if you're going to throw him in the category, you know, with a LeBron or a mm-hmm. Harden? Because people want to label him the MVP. Is he a guy who can do that? It's very un-Spurs-like, but he's going to have to do that and get some LaMarcus with him as well.
I think it's IT for another reason too, though. Financial. His career, the future for him. I mean, this guy's 28 years old. He's trying to play for a possible max contract. He has to prove to either Danny Ainge or the rest of the league, another GM, that I can be the guy. Mm. I can be the guy to carry your team deep into the playoffs. And he hasn't won a series yet. He struggled against the Cavs the first time he was there. Last year, he had one awesome game. He had that 42-point game mm-hmm. in Game 3, I believe it was, against the Hawks. But otherwise, he shot below his averages from the floor in three-point land. So he's got to prove not only to the franchise, but again, to sort of the league, that I'm a max money guy. I'm an all-NBA guard, and you can hitch a ride to me, and I can take you far. So that's a lot of pressure, in my opinion. But Trey, yeah. What's the answer?
I agree. Isaiah Thomas, you got to get that first playoff series win. He gets that pressure right away.
Yeah. Ben Gulliver compared it to Lowry and the Raptors last year, where he's an all-NBA player, but he's got to win a series for sure. All right, when we come back, TASS Awards, the dishonor for worst of the week. Don't go anywhere.
Welcome back to The Starters. Now's the point of the show where we hand out the dishonor to someone in the NBA family that has done wrong in the eyes of the starters. It's time for the worst of the week.
Ladies and gentlemen, the worst of the week.
This week's Worst of the Week is the Basketball Hall of Fame for not electing Chris Webber. We know he's going to get in eventually, so let's speed up the process and save everyone some time. Oh, what? Did he pass too much? Or did he get paid in college? Yeah, that's a first. Listen, the numbers do it justice. His team was the envy of the league for years. He made kids everywhere dunk, pass, and athleticize like him. And he just made me invent a new word, athleticize. C-Webb helped revolutionize the power forward position. He played the right way. Admittedly, the playoff resume isn't out of this world. He went behind the back, maybe to a fault, and he was more well-rounded than dominant some of the time. But those factors should not exclude him. He's too iconic to leave him out. He was asked to pass, doggone it! From Michigan to Sacramento to Springfield, those are the places C-Webb should call home. The Basketball Hall of Fame, unfortunately, your worst of the week. He's going to get in. One day, Chris Webber will get in.
Well, he's made the right steps, right, as we brought up before. He wasn't even a finalist, and at least he was a finalist mm-hmm. this year. Didn't get the 18 of the 24 mysterious votes to get in there, but I agree with you. He should be in there. I think he will be in there. It's just a matter of time, I guess, at this point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was an incredible player, and we've talked about it a lot. 20 and 10 for 15 years.
20 and 10?
Yeah, that's incredible. And in great passer, great basketball IQ, and his teams were great. But they did run into the Lakers with Kobe and Shaq, which was hard. And also
and
that
the referees at points.
And that era as well, you had Tim Duncan and the Spurs, who were fantastic. Kevin Garnett as well, another adversary who he went up against. So sometimes...
That's why it's amazing that he even made five All-NBA teams. He played in maybe the best era of big guys that we've had through the whole thing.
Do you think if he didn't have that controversial college career, and that's what it is at this point now, if he didn't, let's say he just went right straight to the pros, do you think he would be in? Do you think that sort of held him back, I guess?
I don't think so. I think he's a pretty polarizing NBA player in some circles too.
Sure.
He just didn't achieve a lot in the postseason, but that shouldn't exclude him because we know of other guys who are in, and we don't got to go naming names, but Chris Webber actually had more playoff success and team success than guys
some
who
guys
are
in. There.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And individual success. And he's iconic. And, you know, his college career, yes. I mean, some obviously a black mark on it, but again, an iconic team. So I don't know. He's got a resume. I just don't see why not.
I just don't understand. But will he get in next year? I mean, it's a tough
field. And that's what we said too. Like, we thought, I mean, this was a good year for him to maybe get to voted in. You know, Tracy obviously gets voted in, but they looked almost like sort of like a, not a weak class, but an opening there for C-Webb as well. And he doesn't make it. But what, next year, Jason Kidd in the mix. Grant Hill's an interesting one, of course, has the college success with him. It might be tougher for Weber to make it in next year, but he still has time.
Yeah.
So there's still his time. That's a good one, though. Also, runner-up, worst of the week, to Trey Kirby.
Oh, man.
Oh, come on, man.
Cruel.
Apparently, you can only slice Iberico ham by hand, so I guess they're not going to give away a Jose Calderon ham slicer at the Hawks game. Sorry.
Sorry, man. I had to call you. The internet.
Yeah, that's how it goes. Man. That's how it goes. They're killing me on the Iberico ham.
I was looking for Calderon's ham in Spain from Villanueva de Serena from his farm, but I couldn't find it.
Well, coming up next.
One day, maybe.
We'll hit you with the best top 10 list in sports. I ain't kidding. You're watching The Starters.
The Starters on NBA TV is brought to you by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey. Proud partner of the NBA. Do your friends proud. Please drink responsibly.
We asked you guys, what other kitchen gadgets could be NBA giveaways? You hit us up on Twitter, hashtag the starters. TK, you got a few of the best answers.
Yeah, some good ones. This one comes from Rohin, who says, not a kitchen item, but Lance Stevenson air conditioners. It'll blow you away. Throw a window unit in the kitchen, it's fine. Chuck says, a Walt Frazier posting and toasting toaster. The more slots, the better. Shout out to the Twitter show. Bell says, the Jazz could give away a Boris Diaw coffee maker. Odd it hasn't happened yet. Brad says, how about a Maurice spatula? And finally, Baby Blake says, instead of NBA players, what about a J.E. skillet?
Oh, yeah.
Probably chicken, I'm guessing. We'll
fire up those eggs. Like
fire up those eggs.
You know, frittatas. I love my eggs. Love my eggs. All right, good stuff. Keep your tweets coming. Let's get to the top 10 plays of the week at number 10. This block is 99% rating on Rotten Tomatoes.
Oh, that could have been play of the year if he jammed that. He crosses up Paul George.
Get out.
Mm. Yeah, I got you.
Nice.
I know you did.
At number 9, the Avery Bradley steal on TNT. Here we go. It's a race to the hoop. And the huge jam on Kent, on Schroeder, on a lot of people.
Well, Schroeder kind of pulls out a little bit there. But
And one. At number 8, D-League call-up, Troy Williams. Out here playing slam ball, it looks like. Off the trampoline.
Wow.
Throws down the putback over Plumlee.
Monster.
Huge.
LeBron James, watch this block on Marcus Smart.
The double block.
Yeah, packed it right in your face. Then he goes and celebrates with some Celtics fans. Whoa.
Turned already.
Oh, I guess there's one Caps fan.
At number 6, Cody Zeller, come and rescue me. He's back on the top 10 list. Look at this one.
Nice.
Puts the Joker on a poster.
Take that, LeVar Ball. At number 5, Rajon Rondo finds Jimmy Butler streaking.
Whoa.
Jimmy.
Getting up there.
Jimmy, show the hops.
Jimmy's got J's.
Jimmy can throw it down.
At number 4, we got 2 putback dunks from Derrick Jones Jr. Showing off those Gerald Green-like hops.
Man. Pogo stick.
Yeah. I mean, so that one was good.
Yeah.
And this one's better, because this one's on, guys. Oh. Airplane mode activated.
Wow,
next.
Slides. Here's some height. Giannis Antetokounmpo gets way up for this block on Ish Smith.
Give me the replay. Oh, yeah.
Here it is. Get way up. The fingertips.
It's above the box. It's like 11 and a half feet. At number 2, 2 plays from Steph Curry versus the Wizards. Look at the wizardry against the Wizards.
Oh, wow.
Through 3, guys.
The sexy reverse layup, sort of no look.
Oh, man.
That's why Brandon Jennings was mad.
The kiss. And then this one. This was just rude. This was just mean to Marcin Gortat, who's doing his best to stick with him.
He's getting a good workout, though.
I feel bad. He actually gets Curry to pick up the ball.
Yeah.
That's pretty good. Yeah. Not bad here.
That was good D.
Yeah.
He closed out. And then there, and splash. Good try, Gortat.
At number 1, 3 Aaron Gordon plays. You're going to trade me for Dario Saric?
Oh, man.
For AG?
What? You're going to trade me for Dario Saric?
You can catch a reverse.
Oh, that is gorgeous.
Wow.
This one here, a gorgeous jam on Marcus Smart. Marcus Smart. Not doing well in this top 10.
I like how he celebrates with the block.
Yeah, yeah.
And the third one, he loses his shoe on this jam. It's in the middle of the lane.
What?
As he gets up off the backboard from Elfrid Payton, his shoe is on the floor.
Okay, now that's Gerald Green.
Yeah.
Dunking without the shoe on. There it is, Aaron Gordon.
Untie that shoe.
Coming in with the top three plays of the top, what, 15, 16? How many do we do this week? Final break when we come back. Lele's very solid play. You're watching The Starters, presented by Jack Daniels, Tennessee Honey. Coming up on the network tonight, we got a doubleheader. It's the Hawks, caca, at the Cavs, followed by the Thunder and the Suns. Westbrook, of course, just 6 assists shy of guaranteeing that he finishes the season averaging a triple-double. Something tells me he's gonna get it. Next week, guys, a week from today, actually, it's the Starties, the fourth annual Starties, hosted by Chris and Ledlow, where we hand out all of our hardware, your regular NBA awards, as well as some of the Starters' originals, like Very Solid Play, and Meme of the Year, and Fan of the Year, and so on. It's always a blast.
I hope Woj doesn't leak these before they come out.
Yeah, good call. Last night's pick 'em results, not good. We all had the Celtics and the Hawks shut us up, so no one gains any ground or loses any ground between us. Of course, we're playing for something here. In April, it's always the Mrs. Doubtfire Challenge.
Oh, yeah.
Lee's lost it twice. A young Trey lost it 1 year. So we're doing this, no matter what, on Wednesday, April 12th. And if we're tied, I think we get multiple pies. Is that what we're doing?
Sure. Okay. Everybody gets a pie.
So, tonight's game, interesting. Kings at Lakers, Tank Fest. Trey and Tess are taking the Lakers at home. Lee and I are taking the Kings. That'll be fun.
The Lakers don't know how to tank properly.
Yeah, they can't move.
Around the world play, starting in Croatia, goes to America, ends with the Frenchman, TLC. He ain't no scrub from three.
Nice. You went chasing that joke like a waterfall, man.
That's what I call a very solid play.
Great stuff. We had a blast recording the Drop podcast this morning. It's up on iTunes, Google Play, our website. We discussed a few of our favorite things from the 2016-17 NBA regular season, and the guys picked a Bon Jovi song that best describes their fashion sense.
I'll be there for you, because when in doubt, I throw on a Henley. It's always there for me.
Oh, it's my life. It's now or never. Wear whatever you want.
And Lele, take us home.
Keep the faith.
What a clip. Fan signs.
Carter at the Pelicans and Jazz game last week. Put together a very colorful sign there. Well done. This next one is Aiden, Marin, and Connor. And they were at the Bucks game this week.
Bucks Mavs, yeah.
Bucks Mavs, yes.
Whoa, that's nice.
Hunter at MSG put together a very creative sign, drew us all there. Paolo from Italy at the Celtics and Knicks game on Sunday. And Chris and Danielle at the Hornets game on Friday night last week.
All right, guys, we'll see you on Monday.
Thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, Iberico ham can only be sliced by hand.